Rinpoche, talking about identity, what is your general observation of Bhutanese identity? How have we changed over the years?
I don't know how much authority I have in replying this question, because it's an important question. Identity is certainly a very important. It is the identity that is actually, if you really look into our situation in the world, I'm not only talking about Bhutan, it is actually the identity that's really, you know, making you tick. For instance, like British, you know, they can be very critical about themselves. They can be very critical about British government systems, so on and so forth. But as soon as you tease them with French being better, then suddenly that Britishness comes out. Indians, same thing. They're so proud of their identity. Americans, just basically, we human beings, we have identity issue. I mean, here we are not talking about Buddhism. I'm not talking about Buddhism. In Buddhism, we talk about egolessness. So we actually aim for going beyond identity. That we are talking about spiritual path. Here we are talking about social issues, aren't we? So when we talk about social issues, when we are talking about society, yes, identity is absolutely important. And many times, even though identity is so important, many times it is undefinable. What is Bhutanese? What is Indian? It's a very confusing phenomenon, so-called identity. Within a small pocket of human beings, they may be speaking the same language, they may be eating the same food, they may be dressed similarly, but each and every individual will have their identity crisis. I don't know how we should define Bhutanese identity, especially now. The time is changing. And time will change. So is being Buddhist Bhutanese? Not necessarily. It is possible, like in a few years, we will have Bhutanese Zoroastrian, a religion probably which probably some a religion that probably most of the Bhutanese have never even heard of. That is possible. This Kira, Go, Kabne, does this really make us Bhutanese? Yes, maybe on a surface, on a most outer level. But if we don't have an inner strength, this thing can go easily. Within 24 hours, there are few qualities probably we can say is very Bhutanese, such as very jovial and happy, also hesitation to harm another being. And all these things, again, is byproduct of a certain culture or a religion. For instance, like in Bhutan, till now we had Buddhism as the one of the main influence. So even ordinary Bhutanese kid will think twice before he steps on an ant. Is that us Bhutanese? Probably. So I'm not really answering your question. I mean, because it's such a difficult question. It's really difficult. We can always say someone who has the Bhutanese citizenship is a Bhutanese, but those are just papers.
Rinpoche, with the growing number of buildings mushrooming in Thimphu, and there's so many cars also, like increasing number of cars on Bhutanese road. So are we becoming more materialistic, and are we losing our values and culture?
I hate to say this, but the materialism is here and it's going to be here. I think it's here to stay. Here we are, sandwiched in between two most sort of powerful, you know, populated, thriving, and materialistically thriving and developing economically and just in every level. We cannot remain as an ascetic, you understand? As a human being, there is that tendency of insecurity, so there's always this like wishing to have more, wanting to have more security. Those things doesn't help. So I think materialism is here to stay, and it's going to go more, I think, maybe. But unlike many countries, and probably I sort of have a little bit of sympathy for the Bhutanese, but what I want to say is, what we really need to, you know, I think to say, okay, we should not be materialist. This is not a practical thinking. That's not a practical advice. But we can be wise, we can be smart, we can be far-sighted, and then be materialist. We should be materialist not just for now, not just for this month, this year. We should plan so that our materialism will be healthy, sound, and content for next year, next generation, our children. And that is something that I think we Bhutanese are probably not so good, because we are so much rushing into really making lots and lots of money or buying a biggest car or something like that. So I think this is where we are not really thinking properly. I'm not saying that you should not have a lot of money. I'm saying that, yes, we should have money, but why not have money tomorrow, next month, next year, next generation, so on and so forth.
And Rinpoche, talking about art, how much do you think Bhutanese people appreciate art in general?
You know, Bhutanese are known for, you know, good at making things with just one, drosom, or, you know, just one knife. You could, you know, you send a Bhutanese with a knife in the forest and they could cut the tree and they could create something, you know, out of nothing almost. But again, here I like to say, we are not, our art and our ability to appreciate the art is sort of stagnant. It's paused. I don't know why. Probably we are unnecessarily paranoid about old tradition, Diglam Namja, Luxe, Surjun, all of that. All fine, very good. We must have that. But people are changing, you know, human beings are changing. Our children are going to change. We cannot force them to think as how we are thinking. So we need to really be prepared for that. So what I'm saying is, our art has become sort of stagnant. If you go through Thimphu, you know, all the paintings are kind of like copy-paste. You know, it's all like everybody's doing the same thing, probably a little bit of different color. Sort of the creativity is sort of suppressed, I feel. But I guess there's a reason, because we also love our old tradition. But I think we should love our old tradition, we should keep them, but not at the expenses of, you know, like maintaining this tradition, this valuable tradition for a long time, because we could lose it.
Yes, I was reading Rinpoche's What Makes You Not a Bhutanese, and Rinpoche has mentioned about the art, the craft bazaar as well, how Rinpoche was disappointed.
I think this is probably us, you know, we Bhutanese, until now, we managed to be in our society, and we sort of managed to get by sort of, that sort of, you know, like the attitude of, okay, you know, not really going and working for the excellence. I mean, it's funny for me to say this, because I should be talking about, oh, you know, we should not be greedy. You know, we should really, you know, like settle with this. But if you are talking about art, if you are talking about a society, you know, we should really aim for the biggest, grandest, the best. So I feel that it's reflecting to everything what we do. I mean, stuff that we make. I have to say, I'm sorry to say this, but it's not really a good quality, is it? And on top of that, everything that is made in Bhutan is kind of expensive. So only like some, you know, tourists who are sort of intoxicated by our landscape and the whole idea of coming to Bhutan, maybe they buy, or, you know. But other than that, I really fear for the sort of the longevity of the Bhutanese creativity and art.
Rinpoche, is it important for our art and culture to evolve or change over the period of time?
Yes, because the time is changing. We cannot afford to sort of not change. Time is changing, you know, like, and many times for good reason. I mean, we have also changed so much. Like, when, if you send a message to Paro, you don't go ride a horse now. You can't really say, oh, this is our old tradition, we have to send this message on the back of a horse. We just send a text, and that helps us. So, you know, depending on how the time is, you know, changing, how our youngsters are changing, we must change.
Rinpoche, our society is now seeing a growing number of juvenile crimes and cases of addiction. Are we a lost generation now?
I don't think so. No, not in a lost, not a lost generation. I don't think so. I think that's a kind of a, again, this is probably related to identity. Because we have been told to our juveniles, they all go to school, you know, graduate this and that college. There's a lucrative job waiting somewhere. But that's not happening in many cases. And then suddenly you get so disillusioned. Then you go back to square one. Who am I? And as a human being, you like to throw parties. You like to, you know, hug people. You like to, you know, associate with a group. You want to be within whatever, I don't know. And then our society, the modern society, judges people not based on who you are, but how much you have. And then you get isolated and you get alienated. And I think with all these reasons, I think our society, especially younger generations, are suffering right now. This is a modern problem, I think. I don't know how to actually solve that, but it is something that we should talk about it. Is something that we should discuss about it, and I think talking and discussing already helps.
Rinpoche, in recent years, we have seen increasing number of suicide cases, especially among the youth. So what does this indicate?
I've been asked these questions individually, and I wonder. I have, I can imagine must be the stress of the modern world. I can imagine it must be because of competitive world that we live in. It's a bit like this. If I have a gold Rolex watch, by wearing it, I have to also, I may be causing a consequence. You know, there may be somebody who is eyeing at it, who wants to have it, and who envies this kind of, luxury items. And those things cost, not easily available. And so as I said earlier, society is judged by what you have. Oh, you are this person who doesn't have Rolex watch. You get, abandoned, you get alienated, you get isolated. And then I guess this causes the depression, and you don't know how to handle that. And in the past, maybe we Bhutanese know how to sort of get out of that through spiritual path. And probably the spiritual path is not the most exciting thing to do for the younger generation. So then their only solace is like alcohol, drugs. And when that doesn't work, I guess they decide to do suicide, whatever. There must be a lot of reasons. And these are, again, as I said earlier, something that we have to never stop discussing.
So, Rinpoche, is suicide a sin, as per Buddhism?
Well, as per Buddhism, suicide is killing a being, in this case yourself. So, although we don't have the concept of sin in Buddhism, we can say that by taking your own life, you are creating a negative karma of robbing a life.
Generally, Rinpoche, is there a big gap between the rich and the poor in Bhutanese society?
I don't know. Probably not that much as in other countries, but it's going to happen. I think it's already happening. And as I said earlier about the Rolex watch, and probably these are the reasons why there's all this, all these social issues. And this is where I think Bhutanese in general, especially elites, like myself, I have to include myself, Rinpoches, Tashos, elites, the well-to-do families, their children. We have such a big responsibility. We have the privileged people, We have such a big responsibility. If we love our country, if we love our people, if we like to keep our country happy and harmonious for a long, long time, I think Bhutanese elites, especially this generation elites, have so much responsibility. I hear things like Bhutanese, some of the private schools, when the children, when they get picked up in the afternoon, the children show off, what kind of branded car picks them up. And those things create consequences, and those things really create drastic consequences. Probably it's not a good idea to, in many way, in many levels. Probably it's not a good idea to send your Porsche car to pick up your, you know, 2 years old from kindergarten, because it creates consequences. It creates envy. It creates unrest. It creates resentment. Yes, the resentment is something that we need to watch out. And if you look at the situation in many parts of the world where you know, unrest happened, you can say that a lot of this unrest has been caused by well-to-do elites for being totally complacent and totally spoiled and totally, you know, living in their that cocoon, their that zone. I'm not saying that we should not be well-to-do, we should not be rich. By all means, you should. But I'm actually saying we should be even more rich, even more abundant. And how to do that? By sharing. But I'm not, when I say sharing, I'm not saying that you send your Porsche car to pick up other kids. By sharing, it could also mean not sending the Porsche car to pick up your own kid. That way also, individually, your kids don't get spoiled. And that could be also a good thing for the country.
Rinpoche, we talk about youth unemployment while we import foreign workers to work for us. So are we becoming hypocrites and lazy?
I think so, to the certain extent. I think, I don't know, this is maybe very strange for me to say. Sometimes I feel that we Bhutanese have not suffered. We suffered enough. We don't want to, you know, dirty our hand. We don't want to do these, we have all these, I don't know, we have all these ridiculous sort of notion of job dignity, that we all want to be working for as something else, you understand? I think this has a lot to do, this is where, again, the elites and the government, they can do a lot. If they can actually demonstrate vigorously, diligently, by implementing all kinds of programs, workshop, to really to stop this, then I think these problems could be solved. Otherwise, as you are asking, it's very hypocritical. You know, we talk about unemployment, and then yet everywhere you see foreigners working for you, and there's many other things also. Then I've noticed that yet Bhutanese have some sort of a denial that we are the greatest, we are unique, and we don't sort of need to learn from others. Those things are really dangerous cause and condition that can really give birth to a drastic result in the future, something that we should really be aware of.
Last question, Rinpoche. How can Buddhism help us craft and mold our identity, especially as a Bhutanese?
I would not promise that, Buddhism has answer to all of this. I don't want to say this way, because Buddhism is basically, Buddhism and Buddhist are two different things. Buddhism is perfect. Well, as a Buddhist, that's what I think. But Buddhists are not necessarily perfect. They are bad Buddhists, they are good Buddhists, they are, like mediocre Buddhists. Having said that, Buddha's message of interdependence, Buddha's message of love and compassion, Buddha's message of contentment, more than ever, not only in Bhutan, is necessary for the world. The world will benefit from the Buddha's message, such as just pick one, contemplation. Contemplate, sit by the bank of this river without doing anything. Just contemplate about your hair, your body, your nail, something that we never do because we are always thinking about the next thing. Contemplate about how old you are. Contemplate that today is the 9th of the December of 2015. That's like amazing, you know, like so much time has gone. And so much, how much time do we have? So just the contemplation, if you can implement Buddha's advice of contemplation, I think could do a lot of good things for the world and definitely Buddha.
Rinpoche, thank you very much for your time and your insight.